Old School Lame Casual Chats is brought to you by Old School Lame, producing various content from blogs, videos, and podcasts discussing about movies, TV shows, video games, and everything else in between since 2011. You can check out the podcast on Anchor, Spotify, Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Radio Public, Overcast, Breaker, Pocket Cast, and YouTube. We're associated with Channel Frederator, Manic Expression, The Comic Book Cast, and The Arun Mehta Show.
Adventure time! Come on, grab your friends. We'll go to very distant lands. We'll take the dog and then the human. The one will never end. It's adventure time.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to a new episode of Casual Chats. I am Patricia, and I am here with three very special guests, one of which who has been in our podcast many times, Taylor, a.k.a. Whyboy from ToonGrin. Welcome back, Taylor.
Thank you for having me on again.
And we have two new guests, one of which I actually have known for almost a decade on Manic Expression, but this is the first time he's actually been on our podcast. We have Michael McKinney, a.k.a. Fusionater. Welcome.
I'm happy to be here. Thank you.
And we have ourselves a very special guest that I am very happy to introduce. So you probably know him on Tumblr as GuntherFan1992. He has conducted many interviews with some of the people from Adventure Time, and he actually put together an unauthorized book that you can go check out. I'll leave everything, by the way, on the description box below. But he had written the book Exploring the Land of Oo, an unofficial overview and production history of Cartoon Network's Adventure Time. We have Paul Thomas. Welcome, Paul.
Oh, thank you so much. I'm happy to be here.
All right. So, yes, as we've said with Paul's book, today we're going to be talking about Adventure Time. As of the recording of this podcast, it's going to be celebrating its anniversary coming up with its premiere. And it's still going on with Adventure Time Distant Lands on HBO Max. We're still awaiting the two specials. So I'm sure that we'll talk about those in a separate podcast. I don't know if we're going to talk about it individually or all together. I'm still debating on that. But nonetheless, we're going to be talking about the original Adventure Time, the show that Nickelodeon turned down five times, went over to Cartoon Network, became a smash hit, and became probably the most influential cartoon of the 2010s. Good job, Nickelodeon. So, yes, we are going to be talking about everything regarding about Adventure Time, our, you know, how we first got introduced to it, favorite moments, favorite characters, favorite episodes, legacy, all that kind of stuff. So, Taylor, why don't you start us off? How did you first get introduced to Adventure Time?
I basically really got introduced to it probably about like when I was halfway through the series, really, and I just started to see it everywhere. It became sort of like a big meme of sorts and all that, due to it's like it's really, really goofy dialogue and such, like mathematical and such like that. Like, I only got into it first where it's just like, because I knew it was just like, oh, it's big, quirky, and all that sort of jazz. And I really got into it when I basically started to see more of the, you know, the deeper story side of things that basically enveloped you in sort of the more dramatic side of these characters' backstories, including the Ice King, Simon. Like, his backstory really just sort of really gravitated me towards it. I never watched the series all the way through, unfortunately, because I just never got around to it. But I've gotten a few of the first seasons and all that, and I just, like, binged those, and I just loved all the sort of the comedy aspects to it, because it felt like it was really up my lane and all that. Very, very character-driven, and just, leaning towards like sort of the random side of things, but it always had some sort of writing that basically was just very heartwarming to me, I would say.
Oh, I got back into it. I got into it for the first time when it first came out, and I did not like it at all. I didn't get it at all. I thought it was way too weird. I didn't like most of the characters, and I didn't get back into it until very recently. People were telling me I should check it out after watching Steven Universe, and I was like, oh yeah, I can do that. And I was very wrong back then, because as Taylor said over here, it's just got a lot of heart, a lot of charm. The comedy is much better than I remember, which surprised me a lot. It's just a big wild ride that is very well put together for what it is. Adventure Time just has this amazing direction all the way through. They knew what they wanted to be, and they ran with it.
Well, I got into it when it was airing its fourth season. At the time, I felt like I came kind of late to the party, but I think I might have been one of the more earlier adapters out there, all things considered. I had a friend who was really, he was like an art student, he was really into it, and he was always trying to get me to watch it. But I too, like everyone else kind of said, thought it was sort of weird and bizarre at first. I hadn't seen enough of it to really have a solid opinion other than, oh, that looks like stoner humor or like lol random humor. And then I finally sat down and watched an episode, and it was, of course, very bizarre, but it was obvious that it was bizarre in like an intelligent way. It was funny that they were putting together these jokes that were really solid. And so I started watching a few episodes. I enjoyed it. And then I was introduced to Marceline the Vampire Queen, and the rest was history.
Okay, then. Well, yeah, as for me, I got into it because of my cousin. So he was around maybe 11 years old at the time, and he was getting into Cartoon Network. He was getting into, like, Adventure Time, Regular Show, and I was like, I mean, this probably would have been a year before I started Old School Lane. Yeah, my cousin was, like, watching these shows religiously. And one day when I took him to a convention, I think it was MegaCon at the time, and then he told me, can we go over to meet Jeremy Shada? And I was like, okay, sure. I don't know who that is, but okay. And so I brought him over to meet Jeremy Shada, and, you know, he got a picture with him. And then, you know, he started telling me more stuff about Adventure Time, and you know, I started seeing like a lot of the cosplay. I saw a lot of like Finns and Jakes and Princess Bubblegum, Ice Kings, and you know, I was like, okay, you know, when we get home, I'll watch maybe like a few episodes. And and then I started watching it, and I was like, wow, this is like really, really weird. Now, I was familiar with stuff such as The Marvelous Misadventures of Flapjack and Chowder, in which they kind of went to that fourth wall breaking kind of really strange, goofy direction. So I kind of knew what I was getting into a little bit, but I didn't really gravitate to it until maybe around seasons 4 and 5, when this was when I took like maybe a few years off. This was when I was like full on with my content at Old School Lane, just focusing on just nothing but Nickelodeon content. And then, you know, as time went on, when people started just talking more about Adventure Time, and then eventually Steven Universe came along, and then he became a huge fan of that. And then, you know, as time went on, just like, I was like dipping my toe back into Cartoon Network again for like, for the first time in a while. I mean, I still was watching it, but I was mostly watching it for things such as Toonami and Adult Swim, at least when Toonami was there at the time, but then it had its revival a few years later. So yeah, I guess I have to thank him for my introduction of Adventure Time. So yeah, I guess right before we discuss about the show, I guess, you know, a lot of people are going to be wondering about my thoughts of this. I did say that I was going to do a video on it, but what are your thoughts of the initial pilot that was first pitched to Nickelodeon back in 2007?
I can jump in here. As a huge Adventure Time fan, someone who really loves the show and has for 9 years, I don't actually find the pilot as amazing as some people like to talk about. I'm not to say it's not. I think it is good. It's really funny. But I think that you can really see how the show has grown from the pilot, and that there's a cute, fun element there. But I'm glad the show became more than just kind of characters running around saying wacky things and doing wacky stuff. Like, I'm happy that it sort of gained a little more of a reality around it.
Yeah.
That said, the pilot is funny. It is a very sort of charming, silly, kind of rustic looking program or a video, and I'm delighted that you know, Frederator took a chance on Pen Ward and even let him do that, because it's so bizarre, all things considered.
Oh yeah, I mean, Fred Seibert even posted a long, elaborate blog post on his Tumblr account where he was very close of even rejecting it, but then two people from Frederator said, no, this guy has potential. We need to bring him in. And then you know, he sat down, talked to him, and then he saw it, and he's like, oh, well, I almost made the stupidest decision of my life of almost rejecting it. And so then, you know, that's when Random Cartoons picked it up for Cartoon Network. And then, as he said before, what were Nickelodeon thinking when they decided to reject Adventure Time? Like, I mean, I can assure you that that was probably one of the biggest mistakes that they've ever done, because look what Adventure Time spun for Cartoon Network. I mean, it was at the point, if you remember, in 2009, where Cartoon Network was at the brink of death, where they were deciding, yeah, cartoons are dead. Let's bring live action shows.
Oh, God.
I guess, you know, we're, you know, deja vu all over again, because if you guys saw from the Warner Media out front that just happened last week, I think, as they're recording of this podcast, they're doing it again. Yay. This should be interesting.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Cartoon Network has had some interesting, has made some interesting decisions over the year, over the years, and the way they handled Adventure Time, both in picking it up and then also in ending it, kind of sounds like decisions that were made first and then kind of rationalized along the way, rather than decisions that they thought about long and hard and kind of made them coherently, because there was a ton of drama on both ends of that story.
Yeah, most of the good things that seem to have happened with Cartoon Network shows as of late seem to have happened in spite of executives rather than because of them.
Yep, definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, Michael, Taylor, your thoughts on the pilot?
Well, I still haven't seen the pilot, but I can piggyback off what Paul said earlier and say that much of the direction of Adventure Time over time probably changed because of Pendleton Ward, the creator, stepping down as the showrunner and being replaced by Adam Mudo, so Pendleton Ward just became a writer for the show. I imagine that's where a big shift came in play.
For me, it's been a while since I last watched the pilot, so I just pulled it up really quick just to refresh my brain. And I was just like, yeah, basically the pilot did have a lot of really good core concepts and all that, but it really needed the refinement of the actual series and just like, you know, like years of just refining the characters, the actual storylines and such to really become like what Adventure Time is now. Because the pilot is definitely funny. It's definitely got that sort of charm to it, but it didn't really have sort of like a structure that would really just sort of propel it to where it is now.
Yeah, I do agree. I'm going to give a quick little preview of what my thoughts are of the pilot right before you see my video. My initial reactions are more or less the same of what you guys said. It's a pretty decent pilot. It's pretty funny. It has a lot of charm, and it definitely does have the building blocks of what it would become, but there are a lot of differences. I mean, I can akin to, like, you know, they were on the focus of, okay, we're going to have a goofy little adventure about this boy and his dog, and he, you know, he's saving princesses from an evil ice king, and, you know, that was, you know, that was like the initial run, I would say, for like maybe like the first two seasons, I think. And then eventually, like, I would say like maybe like seasons 3 and 4, they completely, you know, changed directions, especially with a lot of the new writers and artists coming in. So, and, you know, this is something that I have not seen in from pilot to final product, at least when it comes to my animated stuff, where a lot of the animated shows that I've covered in their pilots, they always have, like, maybe one or two voice actors that they've, you know, removed and then they replaced with somebody else. Well, most of them have stayed intact. And here, it's the complete reversal. Other than John DiMaggio as Jake, everybody has been replaced. You know, you have Zach Shada, who was Jeremy's older brother, and he was the original Penn, or Finn, as they later changed it. You have John Kassir as the Ice King, which I think that would have been interesting. I would have liked to have seen the Crypt Keeper portray as Ice King. I would have loved that. And Dee Bradley Baker as Lady Rainicorn, and you know, just a lot of pigeon cooing as opposed to speaking Korean that Nikki Yang would do. And the original Princess Bubblegum has changed as well. So yeah, like, everybody is different, and it just is very, like, jarring to me. It kind of reminds me of when I first saw the Invader Zim pilot, and I, you know, heard Billy West as Zim, and I was like, wow, that sounds different. So, yeah, it's like the whole experience was just different. But, yeah, I will say my stuff more in detail in the video, but I just wanted to give off a quick little summary. So, yeah, I guess we can get started on just talking about, like, the show itself. So, I guess, you know, because Adventure Time is so deep with a lot of things, characters, story, moment, I mean, just, like, so much of it, it's not even funny. So, I guess we'll start off with characters. So, who's your favorite character?
Beemo's
great.
Every time they do something where Beemo's imagining things or just running around while everyone's just doing their own thing, it's always just, it warms me up a little bit. It's just, it's always some of the most fun the show has, especially with the voice they gave Beemo with Nikki Yang. Mm-hmm. And it's just excellent.
Yeah, Beemo is such a wholesome robot. Probably one of the most wholesome robots that I've seen in media in a while. Because every time that you see a robot, it's either, oh, this robot's sarcastic, or a genius, or questioning about life. But no, it's like, Beemo just wants to play video games and just wants to make everybody happy. And that's awesome.
Yeah, I totally agree. I love the fact that they didn't make... I mean, Beemo has its angsty moments, but I love that the focus on Beemo is always like make-believe and creativity and these absolute ridiculous role plays and games and stuff, rather than some sort of like iRobot murder mystery fixation sort of thing. Right. Terminator kind of stuff.
I'd say for me, Finn would be like my favorite character. Like, or were you just start off with just being like a hyperactive, really well-meaning sort of adventurer type, and seeing how he basically cracks in terms of just like its own personage. I mean, it's also his emotional baggage from like all angles, really, from the girls he likes, from his dad, and everything else. It basically just morphs into a character that, at first glance, just be like that loud screaming kid, like running around in different directions, but becomes a whole character on his own. It's incredibly funny when it comes to his brother Jake. Is incredibly noble when it comes to the people he's saving, and he just becomes a really admirable character. And he just has that really funny like one-liners when it just comes to like any random moment. Like, I just remember all his times with Magic Man being the funniest.
Finn was easily the best developed character of the series, for sure.
Agreed. Absolutely. You start off with him as a 12-year-old kid, and then he's 17. So you have a 5-year jump where he's completely... You know, if you watch from season 1 all the way to season 10, he is a drastically different character. And you know what? I have to give kudos to Pendleton Ward for not replacing him with another voice actor so that they can keep his youth. Because, I mean, even still to this day with, like, the Loud House, they must have replaced Lincoln's voice actor, like, 5 or 6 times. And, you know, even, like, back then with stuff like Hey Arnold and Recess, in which they cast, like, real kid characters, they constantly had to replace the voice actor because he was hitting puberty. But, you know what? Give credit that they were able to, you know, age him up and have the story continue on in the course of a few years, because that really just made the story richer. And I'm glad that they kept it with Steven Universe as well.
Picking a favorite character really is hard with Adventure Time, because they're all the main ones at least are so well written. But I kind of gave myself away earlier. My favorite character is definitely Marceline. She was the character that I remember seeing and being like, oh, I want to know more about this character. And I was happy that they took her character from kind of like a punk sort of prankster to this very sad emo, you know, lovesick vampire kind of thing. I love how by the end of the show, including the distant land stuff, she's sort of this, you know, scary on the outside, but deeply human on the inside, whereas Bubblegum's like the opposite, like very pretty and perfect looking, but inside kind of like a utilitarian scientist, evil mastermind almost. And I like that dichotomy a lot. And I like both of them together a lot. And so watching those characters develop and change and get more and more fleshed out over the, you know, 10 plus seasons was a real treat and super exciting for someone who liked both of them.
Oh, sure. Yeah, I actually agree 100%. Both of them are fantastic characters. I also love Jake. He's just such a fun, you know, laid back character, but he's very loyal and supportive. And I also love Finn as well. He's such a well-rounded character. You know, Ice King is an amazing character. Like, I didn't really like Ice King when I first saw him, because I just thought, okay, you know, he's supposed to be like the goofy, you know, villain character that's supposed to mess up, and he's really weird. I mean, you know, I was saying, like, before when I did the Pokemon podcast, it's like, okay, you have your goofy, incompetent villain, and they'll never succeed in the end. They're like Team Rocket. They're like the Pilaf gang. Yeah, that's great and all. But then when I saw the Christmas episode, my stance on it completely changed. I'm like, holy crap. You're trying to tell me that this guy was a scientist, and when he put on the crown, his memory started slowly going away and he transformed into this Ice King. It's like, okay, I'm interested now.
I like how they spun it too, where you were sympathetic for him, and there were several seasons where they hadn't fixed the crown or cured him yet. So instead of being this like evil bad guy, he sort of turned into this just like awkward, like the weird sort of Kramer-esque character who would just sort of barge into episodes. And everyone eventually kind of just started to put up with him. And then he eventually became like, not necessarily a hero, but, you know, like Finn went to him to show him like the jokes he was writing in that one episode. You know, he was a character that was no longer evil, just sort of awkward and uncomfortable.
And, you know, as for, like, characters who, like, you know, always just put a smile on my face, I know this is a little bit weird, but I just love Lumpy Space Princess. I do. too. I mean, I just think that she's hilarious. I mean, and you know, kudos for Pendleton Ward giving her, like, this, you know, Valley Girl-esque voice that's just, like, you can't really treat her seriously in terms of, like, she's supposed to be, like, this attractive princess compared to everybody else, compared to Princess Bubblegum, Flame Princess, you know, all the others. But still, I mean, I just, I mean, every
time... LSP was a goddess, excuse me.
I mean, to be fair, I think that, you know, some of the moments with her are always just a standout to me personally. It's just like, you know, everybody thinks that, you know, everybody wants her. And then, you know, she's trying to be like all rebellious from her family. And, you know, she, you know, even though that she doesn't like fully develop compared to the others, I think that she did kind of develop a little bit while at the same time still keeping her spoiled persona of just thinking that she's like the best thing ever. And I just thought that that was like hilarious to me. And you know, there's like so many characters that I can just think of on the top of my head. Like, I mean, just every single one of them just has this unique persona that just makes them so memorable that you want to tune in and watch more of them. And I think that's what the appeal is that if you don't like one character, that's okay. You can just switch on to another character. And I think that that works here because of it's just, it's huge world. And just the fact that everybody is different, they all have their distinct lives and they all have their distinct rules. And you just want to know more about them. It just fascinates you. Yeah, so I guess, you know, characters now done. Let's talk about episodes. So what were your favorite episodes?
Oh, that's a hard question.
It is yeah. A hard question. Yes, it is.
Yeah. Well, I can't remember the name of the episode, but I know the story of it. It's basically, it's Jake's making the perfect sandwich in their house. And then out of nowhere, this magic man comes in and be like, I'm going to take that sandwich. He's like, oh. And like, he gets slapped in the face by Magic Man. Magic Man flies up the window and gets into a big dome of molasses. And then the funny part for me is just like Jake afterwards is trying to be like, I gotta make this other sandwich and all that. And just the universe does not come together for him. You know? Which is my favorite joke. It's just like he just puts like, gets two pieces of bread and some lettuce, puts it together, like, this is good, bites into it. It's terrible!
That is a classic episode. It's yeah. Such as the scene of him making the sandwich that's like 2 minutes long or whatever. He's like, the universe is channeling through him as he's building this monstrosity of food is delightful.
There's also even a similar case with Princess Bubblegum in which she's making the perfect sandwich as well. And the depths that she has to go through to make it, like hitting lettuce with a baseball bat and, you know, putting a little string of a hook just so you can get the perfect slice of cheese and then Peppermint Butler karate chopping the tomato. And then, you know, she worked really hard on it. Then she gives it to Cinnamon Bun. He just sticks it in. He just burps it out with a whole bunch of crumbs. And then he's like, well, thanks a lot. Peace. And it's like, aw, that's too sad.
I think the best detail on that one was when she made the tomato by taking a squid and a red balloon and fusing them like the fly style into a tomato, which I thought was just an absurd visual that was delightful and kind of horrifying too.
It is horrifying, yeah.
In terms of a best episode, this is the question I definitely struggled with the most in preparation for this. I wrote up a list of like my favorite episodes from different seasons, and I came up with like 40 of them. To narrow it down, it's either Hall of Egress, which I think most people are going to would crucify me for not at least bringing up, or James 2, which I think most people will call me crazy for bringing up.
Interesting.
Oh, wow. The story of James Baxter, the greatest horse character in animation.
That is an amazing episode, but I am referring to a different episode. It's the ice cream sandwich man, James.
Oh, gotcha. That one. Okay.
And what other show has the same like characters with two Jameses, you know, that are different? Actually, there's more than two Jameses. Three, four, however many are.
I don't know. I lost count a long time ago.
James Baxter the horse was, of course, modeled after James Baxter the animator, who animated him. A very significant animator in a lot of productions, actually.
Too many to count.
Yeah. But James, too, I love that episode entirely off of the back of one plot line. It's Finn and Jake finally just sitting back and watching the madness unfold, not getting involved. And eventually pulling Princess Bubblegum into that too. And it's like you're sitting there with them and it's just a joyful little moment where you're just watching them.
Yeah.
And it's just nuts.
Man, best episode. Well, I think, like, objectively, if I'm trying to put on my objectivity hat, I would either say I Remember You when we first learned Marceline and Ice King had like a shared past. In particular, that very, very end of the episode where you know something's going on. You're not quite sure. Marceline's sad. Ice King is goofy, but they're singing about something. And then you just get that, like, it's like 10 or 20 second flashback where you're at the end of the Mushroom War and you see Simon, before he became Ice King, like, find Marceline and give her Hambo. And it's just, like, heartbreaking. The problem with that episode is that if you don't know the characters, it's a very hard one to introduce people to, because they're like, I get that this is important, but I don't know who these people are, so it's not as emotionally powerful.
I mean, who would introduce Adventure Time with a later fourth season?
I don't know, but people are always like, oh, you gotta show them I Remember You, and on like Reddit and stuff, and people are like, no, you gotta save that one, because that's the one that's gonna, like, you gotta lull them into that false sense of security with all the fart jokes first, and then hit them with that one.
It's like with As Told by Ginger, when somebody was asking me, is there, can I watch it, like, in any out of order? And I'm like, no! Because, first of all, if you want to know about the episode No Hope for Courtney, and you want to know about the significance and the power of the emotional scene where Mrs. Gordon dies, you need to watch all the episodes of As Told by Ginger so you can lead up to it. Then it'll become a heart puncher. So, yeah, you can't just, or, you know, with Hello Stranger, or Come Back Little Seal Girl, or Losing Nana Bishop, or The Wedding Frame. You need to watch the episodes in order for you to appreciate these moments. You can't just pick an episode and you're like, oh, this is the good episode. But wait a minute, this is a moment where a character, you know, reveals information that is important that was heavily implied like a season ago. It's like, no, you can't do that. I mean, I get their intentions, but that's a bit botched.
Yeah. And if people want an episode that's really emotional that they can understand, that's why I think the one the go-to I have is It Came from the Nidosphere, when we first meet Marceline's dad, because you don't really know Marceline at that point that much. But within with the Fry song, you're like, oh, this vampire girl and her father, who apparently is Satan, they have a problem. And the rest of the episode is just trying to figure that out. And it's very funny and it's very sweet. And you don't need to have a ton of backstory to understand it. And of course, it's just ridiculous, just off the charts ridiculous. But still, that was one of the first episodes that I think really had that emotional core that a lot of people started to notice and be like, oh, this show's really funny, but it also, you know, can make you care for the characters too.
Yeah,
I actually do know several people who only watched the Ice King plot episodes of Adventure Time.
I know people who only watch Adventure Time just for the bubblegum and Marceline backstory.
Oh, man. The people on Reddit and Twitter, people are always like, what are the plot episodes of Adventure Time? And other Adventure Time fans are always like, you can't do that. You either go in and just watch it and say, that episode was good, I didn't like that episode that much, or you just don't watch it, because, like, jumping around to the quote-unquote best episodes is not going to make any sense. And plus, you're going to miss a bunch of really funny ones that maybe you personally think are delightful, but maybe not everyone else. Like James 2, for instance. Not my favorite episode, but the fact that you found that to be, you know, your favorite episode is fascinating, because it's not what I would consider like a plot heavy episode.
For sure. And that's the thing. It's like everybody, you know, has their own taste of what they like. You know, they can be able to go into either a heartwarming episode, an emotional episode, or a funny episode, and they'll equally be just as satisfied. But yeah, I do agree that you really need to, like, watch the whole thing through in order for you to get fully invested. I know it's, like, a lot. It's over 280 plus episodes. But, you know, for all of my listeners who are anime fans, it's like, that's nothing compared to, like, watching One Piece or Detective Conan. It's like, yeah, you're basically just, like, watching, like, all of Naruto. So yeah, you're good.
Yeah. At least half the episode, something.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And, you know, they're even half the time, where, you know, like, a lot of these are like 24 minutes. It's only like 11 minutes long. And I even said this many, many years ago when I was talking about the top 10 Angry Beavers episodes, about the advantage of trying to squeeze so many things into an 11-minute episode. And I was saying that it's really, really hard to do. It's not as easy as you think it is. I was saying about, like, you know, for shows like Fanboy and Chum Chum or Breadwinners or Sanjay and Craig, in which, you know, they try to squeeze like so much insanity into like a small time slot, but they lose focus on the story sometimes. Some of the character interactions are probably not as strong, and they rely a lot on crazy random humor. And I even said it in my video, it's not being crazy for the sake of being crazy. It's done with purpose, finesse, great writing, and great character interactions, which I said about the Angry Beavers episode. And I see a lot of it here in Adventure Time. They're able to squeeze so much in 11 minutes. Like, emotion, laughter, character development, like, it's all pushed into, like, 11 minutes. And that is an amazing feat. Now, as for my favorite episode, that's really hard because... I understand that, you know, so many people, you know, they have, like, personal preferences as to, like, personal favorite episodes. And, you know, an episode that, like, they mean a lot to them, like, whether it be funny or whether it be, you know, heartwarming or sad or anything like that. But if I had to choose something, like, one that I would watch over and over again, and I just feel so much satisfaction, especially since I have seen the entire series, my favorite will probably be Simon and Marcy.
Episode.
Yeah, it's so great. Yes. I love how funny it is. I love how heartwarming it is. Just, you know, when we got to see I Remember You, and we got to see, like, them together just for, like, 20 seconds. But then you're, like, thinking, oh, man, I want to know more about that. And then we did, and it was so worth it. I never thought in a million years before I started watching that episode that the Cheers theme song would make me cry.
Yeah.
I mean, it's supposed to be welcoming, you know? Sometimes you want to go where everybody knows your name, but then you're like, wait a minute. This song is about Simon trying to keep his memory so that he doesn't lose it completely so he can keep protecting Marceline. It's like, oh, where are the tissues?
I like that one, too, because that's a good episode where, unlike I Remember You, you don't necessarily have to know all the characters to get it because they take you to that flashback. So you're like, okay, it's like zombies, I think, post-apocalyptic. Simon's, like, got a magic crown. Marceline's a little girl. That's all you really need to know. And so it really, you can really latch onto it and figure out, even if you're not super invested in the characters. But of course, knowing those characters and knowing their backstory, it's even more rewarding because you're like, we're finally getting that information.
Yeah.
Speaking of the Cheers song showing up in that episode, I should say that outside of cartoons, I don't really listen to music at all. So when he started singing a song and it's like halfway through, it's like, wait, I know this song. That's not possible. So that's all I could focus on at the time. Not the plot stuff, not that. It was just, man, this is weird. I don't know music.
Yeah, I kind of feel the same way when I listen to the Mr. Belvedere song in the Stakes miniseries. It's like, I know that song, but it's on the tip of my tongue. What is it from? And then I looked it up and it's like, oh, it's Mr. Belvedere. Okay. I mean, I've heard of it. Like, I've heard people talking about it, like, you know, like on, you know, best TV theme songs. I think it was like VH1 did a video about it or something, like many years ago when they used to do like their top 100s or something. But yeah, it's like, you know, way to take, you know, theme songs that, you know, a lot of people already knew about and just do something different with it, but at the same time pack an emotional punch that's, you know, just as important as in, like, the standalone theme song.
I do love that in that when they introduce the Mr. Belvedere theme, when the humans are, like, gathered together and one of them's like, art must continue, and then he launches into, you know, a goofy theme song from an 80s sitcom. Whatever they can find of human culture is considered art now, and it's enjoyable.
Yeah, and, you know, both theme songs were written by the same person, which was a major coincidence that I found to be hilarious.
Yeah, I actually emailed the guy who wrote the songs, and I was just like, can you tell me the story there? And he's like, I don't know. He was happy they used him, but he knew nothing of Adventure Time.
And oh, wow.
He watched the episodes and was like, okay, I mean, I get kind of the Cheers one, like, it's got that sort of emotional nostalgia feel.
Yeah,
he was like, I don't understand the Mr. Belvedere one other than, you know, they like my music.
Okay, next Distance Lands episode, I want to hear the theme song of Punky Brewster.
Oh, heck yeah.
Yes. I know it's going to be about Peppermint Butler next, but you know what? Do it. I don't care.
They might. You never know with this show.
That's true. You never know, for sure. Speaking of the Stakes miniseries, like, you know, there were three miniseries that occurred in Adventure Time. Stakes, Islands, and Elements. And, Stakes is probably my favorite one because it was so interesting to see more of Marceline's backstory in addition to, like, the five vampires. Like, just, it was so cool to see them. Yeah, you know, you have the Fool, the Empress, the Hierophant, the Moon, and then the Vampire King. And I saw Elisa Hansen's video where she was discussing about it and about how they were based off of tarot cards and, you know, all the deep, you know, references that the tarot cards had in integrating into the characters, and, you know, and how, you know, she was trying to explain the story on, you know, where people felt it was a bit of a cop-out that Marceline turned back into a vampire, and then she was giving, like, this explanation on why it had to happen. And I just thought, that's a really interesting analysis. Now, as somebody, I don't follow tarot cards or any of that kind of magical stuff, but just seeing it from a different perspective, as opposed to, like, a person who's just, you know, reviewing it for, like, writing's sake or from a story standpoint, I was like, that's interesting. I never thought of that.
I love the Stakes miniseries, and I, too, often get in arguments with people about the returning to the status quo, because I remember seeing it for the first time and I was like, oh, this is like Nietzsche, you know, like the eternal return and like loving your fate and stuff like that. And it was like, I remember reading Jesse Moynihan, who was one of the board artists, mentioned something like that. And so, and not to be one of those people that's like, you have to read Nietzsche to understand it, but it was cool to see them like working with Nietzsche, you know, of all people, for this very, very kind of melancholic but triumphant miniseries where Marceline kind of looks into the, you know, the eye of fate, sees that she has to be a vampire no matter what, so she may as well just do it, you know, out of her own volition rather than kind of be drugged kicking and screaming into the world of vampirism. And it's just a very triumphant sort of sad moment where she's like, I am becoming the vampire queen. I know it's going to be the, you know, my curse, but that's okay. I'm cool with it. And I liked that a lot. It's a very existential, very, very dark conclusion, but also like optimistically triumphant in a way.
And I like the tragic that. Thing is that it is absolutely the happy ending for Bubblegum.
Yeah, that's true. Well, I think that's another thing is like you couldn't doom Marceline to a life, you know, like immortality without at least her having a friend, a friend at least, you know. So I was glad that they were starting to set up the, I mean, they'd been setting up the romance for a while then, but at that point it started to become really clear that was kind of in game. I also liked Stakes because of that too.
Yeah, I think that one of the first times that they kind of hinted on that was What Was Missing, where she was singing I'm Just Your Problem, where she was talking about like, oh, you don't like that? Or maybe you just don't like me.
Yep. Drama bomb.
Drama bomb. Yes. Yeah, so it's not to say that I don't like the other miniseries. I mean, I do. I really liked Islands, where we got to know more about Finn's past. I mean, I thought that was just really fascinating. And I, you know, Elements was a blast. It was like really hilarious and get to see like all the other characters, you know, like where the elements just went way too far. And then, you know, it would just lead up into like the final crux of the series where we have the Gum War. So, yeah, I thought that, you know, each one of them did something really unique and different. And I really like that.
I thought, I know I've, again, get in discussions with people all the time about best and worst episodes and stuff. And I think people really loved Islands, but I think the people that really loved Islands also really, really loved Finn as their favorite character.
Sure.
And I don't dislike Finn by any means, but of the main characters, he's probably one of the least interesting, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. And so I was like, I really enjoyed it, but I didn't find it amazing. I thought Stakes was amazing. And it's sort of like the inverse. A lot of people think Islands was amazing, but Stakes wasn't as good. Either way, I think all three of them were fun. They did really smart, clever things. And even Elements, which I don't think necessarily propelled the plot too much. I mean, it did. It brought it kind of the show to the end. But, you know, it was more kind of a goofy, fun adventure. It was still really fun. Just a silly, colorful, goofy, you know, 8-episode arc that really reminded me of the show's earlier days.
I felt it was needed, considering of how much drama that we had gotten in Islands.
I agree. Yeah, it was nice. Yeah. It was refreshing.
Islands really picked up in the second half a lot, too, whereas both Stakes and Elements, in my opinion, were very consistent throughout, just being strong storytelling.
Yeah, I think the heights of Islands are probably the highest of the miniseries, but the other two are a little more even in terms of how they were like blocked out and stuff.
Sure.
Although that scene at the end of Islands, the very first episode, when Finn like takes his hat off and is like staring into the like the coast on there on the boat, I remember seeing that and getting like chills because I was like, oh man, something's gonna happen. This is gonna be a big thing, you know.
And then he never visits his mom. Monster.
Yeah, it's kind of like in like Land Before Time, in which Littlefoot finally finds his father for the first time ever, and then you're like, oh wow, they finally reunited, and then the father's like, don't worry, someday I'll visit you in the Great Valley, and it's like we had to wait another like what like another 5-6 years for that in the TV show, and then the 14th movie, it's like, yeah, there's your consistent visiting, yeah, absolutely. I guess, you know, we were talking about songs earlier, so I guess we need to talk about, like, favorite songs of Adventure Time, because that and Steven Universe have, like, some of the best songs that was featured in a TV show over the past decade.
Absolutely.
Heck with the past decade ever.
Well, yeah, I mean, I guess I was just rounding it up, but yes, I agree, ever. I mean, I haven't heard, like, this round of songs in, like, in succession that are so good in a long time. Like, I mean, I can think of a few others. I mean, like, Hey Arnold has a few good songs. A Chalk Zone has a few good songs. But yeah, like, you know, just like consistently over and over again with like, you know, Adventure Time, where, you know, they're like listened to constantly on YouTube, and I'm on Spotify now, and it just skyrocketed when the Obsidian soundtrack was released over there. And it's just amazing. Like, a lot of these songs are just phenomenal. And, you know, a lot of it is credited to people like Rebecca Sugar, who wrote some of the best songs in Adventure Time.
Yeah, the songs in Adventure Time, they wouldn't really be the same without Marceline, though, now that I'm just looking at all of them right now.
I agree.
Yeah.
It's she's responsible for like 2/3 of the great songs in the show, and it's almost making me think, I take back what I said earlier, Marceline's the best character, sorry, BMO.
You know, BMO has had, you know, its fair share of songs, but yeah, if we're talking about songs-wise, yeah, Marceline, best character, don't at me. Yeah, I mean, like, a lot of the songs that people, you know, that she would sing, you know, the Fry song, I Remember You, I'm Just Your Problem, Francis Forever, and even the stuff from Obsidian, such as Woke Up and Monster, are still just absolutely incredible to listen to.
Woke Up in particular, just, it hit differently.
I agree.
Knowing the episodes that it was, that it harkened back to, especially that first episode where we first learned that they could have a relationship potentially.
Yeah.
I agree. I love that horrific diss track kind of thing. She didn't really want to say it, but she was like, I'm going to do this because you hurt me. I guess it's a Marceline song. Yeah, because she sings in it. It's the house hunting song from the Evicted episode with Pendleton Ward singing. Like, he's sort of narrating Finn and Jake trying to find a house. And it's just so silly and high intensity, goofy energy. And that's, of course, when Marceline sings her famous line about she's not mean, she's just 1,000 years old, and she's just lost track of her moral code, which is a great little line. But there's so many songs in this show, it's hard to pick one.
It is hard to pick one, yeah.
I do say that Marceline is responsible for the great music in this show, but she actually didn't sing my favorite song.
Oh, what's your favorite?
It's Come Along With Me.
Yeah, I was about to basically say that was the dark horse in my mind, because like anytime I think of Adventure Time, I just think of just the ending credits song.
Yes.
I like how calming it is, and how it just usually, and especially in the first season, it just offset all the craziness that just happened, and just cuts to be like, come along with
Have you all seen the finale?
Yes, and yeah. In the finale too, when it gets extended, it's the entire show. It's always so sad when it gets cut off.
Yeah, Frederator. Yeah, I remember sitting on the couch when I was watching the finale with my wife, and Finn and Jake are like sitting by the music hole, and they pan back to the music hole, and I was like, oh no, I know what's gonna happen, because that's the voice. That's the Ashley Erickson who wrote the song is the voice of the music hole. I was like, they're gonna do it. And then, you know, the drums come in, and it was, that song was always so fun and happy. And in that moment, it was just like this really bittersweet sadness I felt. Obviously, it's a beautiful song, and I was happy with the episode, but I was like, oh no, the entire show was building up to this moment, and this is heartbreaking.
Yeah, absolutely. And when it comes to ending theme songs, I mean, you don't really hear a lot of people talk about, like, oh, you know, what are the best ending theme songs? They always talk about opening theme songs. They always talk about, like, songs that are featured in the show. But ending theme songs is not one that I really hear a lot of people talking about. And, you know, kudos for that, for, you know, putting that much care and detail to the ending credits as much as the opening credits. Because, you know, nowadays, ending credits are either, like, really short or non-existent. And, you know, because we need to, you know, go to the next show really, really quick, they just, like, flash in the people's names. And then that was it, and then you just go over to the next one. So yeah, I'm really glad that they were able to, you know, have that song in there, because it just shows you that, yeah, we can take a nice little calm break after all the insanity that you just went through. So yeah, that was, like, really relaxing. And then, you know, depending on what episode it is or what miniseries it is, they always change up the ending credits, or even the opening credits, you know, where they have, like, different people featured. And I thought that that was a really nice touch, because it makes it like, oh yeah, this is something different going on. Like, whether it's Fiona and Cake, or whether it's the Stakes miniseries, or Islands, or Elements, it's like, oh yeah, we're doing something different. So yeah, I really like how the series sometimes just keeps you on your toes.
Agreed.
Yes,
agreed, because that's usually just sort of like a practice that's only practiced in most animes and such, where they actually, like, evolve the opening as their series goes on. You don't really see it as much with Western cartoons like this, with Adventure Time being the only one that really stands out in my mind, where I can actually evolve with whatever it's showing and such.
All right, so yeah, I guess the last thing that we want to talk about is just, like, the legacy that this show left behind, because, yeah, as I mentioned earlier in the podcast, like, because that Cartoon Network picked up Adventure Time, it was able to have its creative heads being able to spin off and create their own programs. J.G. Quintel with Regular Show, Patrick McHale with Over the Garden Wall, Rebecca Sugar with Steven Universe, Ian Jones Cordy with OKKO, Let's Be Heroes, like... This one show effectively just changed the landscape of all of Cartoon Network and of animation in general. And I just thought, wow, that's just so fascinating to me. And then, you know, when people look back on it, like, over 10 years later, it's like, you know, what would animation be if Adventure Time wasn't picked up by either Nickelodeon or Cartoon Network or anybody? It just makes you think.
Yeah, it really was sort of a jump starter for so, not just, like, a lot of stuff, because, you know, a lot of shows can generate talent, but, like, a lot of really good stuff. Like, the fact that Adventure Time produced, you know, Steven Universe and OKKO and I guess kind of Regular Show, even though that was kind of in the works already. And
yeah, it's kind of in the Clarence. Works, but JG, yeah, and Clarence, yeah.
Yeah, that was, you know, stuff like that. Like, a lot of these, you know, oops, all bangers kind of a situation. That's impressive. And it goes to show you that I think that, like, Penn and Adam really sort of knew who to hire or, like, who to trust. That's what it sounds like when you hear interviews with Rebecca Sugar, for instance, that she was always kind of self-conscious of her decisions to, like, put in a song or write a character this way. And Penn was always like, no, that's really good. And then that's what the fans loved, you know, and that's what made Steven Universe so impressive.
Yeah, and it's very impressive because you have a mixture of, like, old veterans in the animation industry as well as new people. You know, you have people like Kent Osborne and, you know, various others, people who, like, worked on SpongeBob and Flapjack. And then you have, like, the newcomers coming, you know, presenting their work and having the potential to even do their own shows. And then, you know, who knows about, like, you know, which creative minds would work on their shows in the future. So, yeah, it just basically builds up this really interesting... you know, pyramid of, like, all of these, you know, like, the foundation is here, and then, you know, we're in this part now, and it's all because of this. So it's just crazy to, you know, think about. And, you know, even when I was, like, going to conventions with my cousin, and I wasn't, like, steeped into Adventure Time stuff, you know, you have a lot of the cast would, you know, come over there, and then there would be, like, long lines of people waiting, and there would be, you know, like the booths would be, like, constantly filled with people, and, like, the Q&A sessions would be just filled to the brim. It's just absolutely insane when I, you know, first saw that. And I you know what, I sometimes, you know, this was back when I was still focusing on my Nickelodeon stuff, and, you know, when I look back on it now, I was like, man, I missed out so badly. Like, I could have been there. You know, I could have, like, you know, been in those Q&A sessions. I mean, I was, like, you know, doing it because, you know, my cousin was into it and he was the one doing it. But, like, the fact that I wasn't doing it, I wasn't, like, participating in the Q&A panels, and I wasn't, like, you know, in line getting pictures with people and all that kind of stuff. And the opportunity was there. It's like, I just kick myself knowing that I could have had that chance and I missed out. And even with, like, interacting with the community, it's like, I felt like I could have, like, been there at some point. But no, but you know what? I mean, that's a good thing about fandoms. It's like, you know, it's never too late to get into something, even if it's like a decade old or even like further than that. It's like, you know, there'll still be like a fan base out there, and there'll still be people doing fan art and fan fiction and, you know, doing all these interesting theories and whatnot. So yeah, I mean, in a way I did feel kind of regretful that I missed out when it was still new, but now that, you know, it's still, you know, still praised by a lot of people and people are still revering it, it's like, okay, you know, even though I got into it a little bit later than I wanted to, I'm glad that I'm in it now.
Agreed. Yeah. Watching like panels and stuff on YouTube, from older cons and stuff, I'm like, oh man, that'd been so cool to go to.
Watching some of the older interviews, between the creators, especially the ones they put on the DVDs, really do show how good of friends all these people were. So I just imagine that some of the panel stuff and some of the community stuff was just amazing back then. But like you, I wasn't really involved at the time.
Yeah, watching Adventure Time now just makes me just more appreciate just where they pushed animation forward. Because I never really got into like the fan base sort of stuff. Just for me as like creative type, making my own sort of shows and all that. Adventure Time basically made a lot of people more braver in like experimenting more with basically making stupid cartoons, quote unquote, but also adding intelligence to them. And then it just became all these shows that you listed before, for basically became what everyone really wanted. The audience asked for that, and more of them came from it because of Adventure Time. It makes me just want to watch more Adventure Time to really just appreciate it more, especially as it's still continuing on.
Yeah, speaking of which, thank you for that lead up, Taylor. Like I said earlier in the podcast, I don't want to go deep into Distant Lands because two of the specials are not out yet. So when they are all out, I want to have maybe you guys back on the podcast to discuss about more of them, more in depth with them, whether it be standalone or whether it be with all four of them together. I still haven't decided that part yet. I know that a lot of our listeners from Europe and from Australia and New Zealand are just now getting HBO Max, but I just want to preface this saying that if you have not seen Distant Lands, you know, you can probably skip out on this portion and then maybe like go over to like the conclusion. But yeah, I really want to talk about them because I just feel like they're just so important. So yeah, so Distant Lands. So far we have about two specials, one about BMO and the other one about Marceline and Princess Bubblegum. So both of them, I feel, have their own strengths. Like BMO has this really interesting story where you have like these group of people who are in this like close-knit society being controlled by this one person who's kind of like screwing everything up. But at the same time, you know, Bima's trying to be very helpful and he interacts with the little rabbit Y5. And I just thought that was really cute and adorable. And the mystery of Mr. M was kind of interesting, which I think a lot of people have made their theories as to who Mr. M is, which it's pretty obvious if you've seen the show. And then, you know, you have the finale where we find out, oh, it's a prequel. It takes place even, you know, before the events of Adventure Time. And then with Obsidian, it goes more into backstory, where you have Marceline and Bubblegum. You get to know more about Marceline's backstory that people have been wanting to know about for a long time, more about her mom, more about her experiences growing up during, you know, after the events of the Mushroom War, the relationship between Marceline and Bubblegum, how they broke up, how they first met. And just overall, just a nice closure to Marceline's backstory, where, you know, she's now finally made peace with herself and she's now become much more of a grounded person, where, you know, like when she first came into the show, she was like this, you know, prankster who just basically pushed people away at points. But then she's becoming more accepting and she's opening up to herself more, and she has really grown as a character. The problem is that the location and the characters that they meet along the way are nowhere near as interesting as BMO.
Agreed. The Glass Kingdom was neat, but like, I didn't care too much. They could have put that really anywhere.
Sure. Most of the characters in the Glass Kingdom really weren't all that likable, whereas in BMO, it could be its own show.
Yes. Yeah. Sure. Yeah, Y5 was like, you were rooting for the character. Whereas with Glass Boy, I I kind of felt like that was almost a dig at like people like me who absolutely love Marceline. The scene when Simon brings him over to her and Bubblegum's house, and they open the door and he sees her for the first time and she's like silhouetted in light and stuff. And he's like, oh my gosh. I was like, yeah, I kind of relate a little too much to that. But also he was an annoying little rascal at times and caused the entire thing to begin with. So it was sort of weird for us to want to root for him when he was responsible.
Yeah, and you know, nothing to say bad about Michaela Dietz.
Oh, her voice acting was great.
Yeah,
the voice was perfect.
Yeah, she did a phenomenal job, as well as the voice actress behind See-Through Princess. But, oh man, like, I couldn't care less about this. I think I even read this interesting theory once where they were saying there was a correlation between Glass Boy and Moto Larvo, in which, like, you know, Glass Boy had a crack on his head and Moto Larvo had a crack on his head, and there were supposed to be like parallels to each other. And I was like, that could have been great if they actually did it.
There's just a little scene with Moto Larvo where it's during the monster song where you learn kind of the backstory, and it's like hinted at right there, but they don't really explain it other than that.
Yeah. Speaking of the monster song, you interviewed the person who wrote the song, Half Shy.
Yeah, that was an interesting experience. Very, very nice person. Very talented musician.
Yeah. And yeah, I even mentioned her in my recent video where I talked about the four stories on how fans became integral to being a part of their favorite show, where she wrote a lot of Adventure Time fan songs even before she became officially part of the show.
Yeah. It was the literally sort of a fan dream come true when she was telling me this, that she just put these songs out there. And then Adam Muto was like, hey, I really like your music. Would you like to write a song for the show?
Yes.
And she, if you look at like, yeah, her Twitter and her Instagram, she has like a couple hundred, like before the episode came out, she had like a couple hundred people liked her page. So she was like, I don't want to say obscure, that's not the right word, but you know, like she was a fan just putting out music, doing her own thing. And then he reached out and asked her to do that. And she said she was really nervous and worried that, you know, kind of you'd mess it up. But I thought she did an amazing job. I thought that song was really, really heartwarming.
Yeah. Yeah. You can read more about her, you know, stuff on your Tumblr, right?
Yes. Yeah. And I actually just posted an interview with James Baxter, the animator, who I was able to get into contact with. So not to do a little plug, but I'll do
that. No, that's okay. We'll do that at the end of the show.
Plugging is half the fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you know, not to say anything, you know, not to leave Zuzu out of the, you know, out of the discussion, where she wrote Woke Up and Eternity with You. And, you know, she is, I believe, a singer from Liverpool. And, you know, she also did a phenomenal job as well.
I tried reaching out. I couldn't get in contact. I got her manager, but then it all kind of ended.
I don't know how huge she is in the UK, but I'm sure that, you know, I'm sure at some point you will get a hold of her, and that'll be really interesting to find out.
Hopefully. I'll keep bugging.
Yeah. And, you know, of course, I can't leave out Amanda Jones, who also did the background music as well. And that, you know, the music also plays really well into the atmosphere of the special as well. I guess, you know, again, with the other two specials, they're not out yet, so we still are awaiting, you know, the other ones, which I'm surprised that there was no announcements on it, because, like I said earlier, Warner Media did their upfront, and there was no announcement on Adventure Time Distant Lands. I mean, they talked about all their projects coming up for Cartoon Network and for, you know, WB with their lineup of movies that they're going to be releasing, but yeah, yeah, no Distant Lands. And I was like, oh, well, I mean, we'll just, I hope it comes out soon, because I'm interested in seeing what the other two are going to be.
Yeah, me too. I'm really excited for both of them. They both look really intriguing.
Yeah, I'm looking forward the most to Together Again. I want to know, especially since we saw that ending of, you know, Finn's tattoo.
Yep.
Yeah.
I'm worried, though.
It really did seem like they were hinting at something rather morbid for Jake, which would have been sad.
I mean, especially since the flowers that are around Jake are forget-me-nots.
Yep.
And, you know, a lot of people were very, very horrified by it, but I also, there was a part of me that was like, it kind of feels right. Not to say that I want Jake to die, but like, it would emotionally make sense that if something, if Finn had to lose someone, it would make sense for it to be Jake.
It would also practically make sense, too, because they sort of established over the course of Adventure Time that Jake was aging at the rate you would expect a dog to.
Yeah, I'm worried, but I'm sure that they'll figure out a way to make us cry and be satisfied at the same time.
Absolutely.
If these four specials do really well, I mean, maybe they'll even expand it to maybe 8 episodes or 13. Who knows?
I think as long as they have the right people working on it, I think they should, you know, the universe is so massive that they could do mini series and probably whole seasons about different people in different places, and it would be satisfying for many of the fans at least.
You can focus on like anybody. I mean, you can make one about Betty and Simon. That would be amazing, by the way.
That would.
I want a Patience special.
Patience was a villain. I will say that I feel like she didn't get to shine as much as I wish she had of, or could have, because I think there was a lot of potential there.
But yeah, overall, so guys, give your final thoughts.
Watch Adventure Time. It's pretty good.
Yeah, I think that's it. Like I said, it's just a wonderful show. And it's just like, it at face value, it looks really stupid. But just when you just like peel a little bit, you just see all the intelligence underneath it. And it just pulls you in again and again with its wonderful characters.
I think that Adventure Time fundamentally, this is might sound a little pretentious and silly, but I think Adventure Time fundamentally captures what it means to be a human, because it's both silly and stupid and smart and like intellectual and sad and happy. And it's all of these, it's just like these ambivalence of emotions all mixed together, and you feel things that are good and bad and, you know, again, sad, happy. And it can be really smart, but it can also find humor in a fart joke. So sometimes you sit down and you don't know what you're gonna get, but it's always gonna feel genuine and real. There's this genuineness to it that is very beautiful and something that caught me off guard when I first finally saw it. And I think, you know, if you've never seen it or haven't really given it a chance, you know, watching a couple episodes, I think you'll see that sort of genuineness kind of come through. And it's just a really beautiful program.
Yeah. Now, hang on. Those were both amazing reasons. I had to do slightly better than that. Adventure Time is probably the best example shown for human maturity, as you brought up, but in particular for children, that I've seen with how they developed Finn's character. So if you want to just see a really realistically done kid learning his way around the world, it's a good reason to check out the show.
Yeah, I
agree. That's a great point too.
Yeah, definitely.
It's always funny too when you say that to people who've never seen it and they're like, wait, the show with the talking dog that can like stretch is realistic? And you have to be like, I know it sounds strange, but just trust me on this one.
I talked about this 6 years ago when I was first doing my mini series on the Nickelodeon Slimecast podcast called Nick Smissel, where we talked about canceled projects that moved over to other networks. And I said this about Adventure Time, and I think it still stands, that I've seen one of two camps. I've either seen people who love the adventure part, but they don't like how it got serious. Well, at the other hand, I've seen people who love the more heartwarming and powerful serious moments, but they don't like the fart jokes. So it does cater to a lot of tastes, and maybe it may not cater to yours, but I would say just give it a fair shot, and you'll see that the journey that it takes you in will be just so, so worth it. I mean, I know that it could be like really weird at points, but trust me when I say this, I would give it a fair chance, and you'll be taken into a journey that you will, I can assure you, you will never forget.
Could All right. always watch it in reverse order.
Oh, you know what? That would be really interesting. Like, they de-age over the course of a few years.
I never thought about that.
I've never thought of that either.
I was only half kidding, because, yeah, it's like, I think it would be an amazing distillation of how the show progressed, but very strange to watch.
That or is you could do, strange. Like, the first episode, last episode, second to last episode, and, like, have it ping-pong back and forth until you hit the equilibrium point.
Yeah, I think a lot of podcasts do that, where they like talk about, okay, this is how a show's progression is. They'll talk about the first episode, they'll talk about the middle episode, and then they'll talk about the last episode, and then they'll just look at it in depth and it's like, okay, this is where it goes, this is where it's gone, this is where it's going, this is where it, you know, it was before. So I'm actually curious if anybody's ever done that. If so, then please leave a comment down below. I definitely want to listen to their thoughts on it. But yeah, that's pretty much it for this episode of Casual Chat. So guys, thanks again for coming on by. I really do appreciate it.
Yeah, no problem. It was fun. Thanks for having me.
Yeah,
same for me. It was a beautiful time.
So yeah, why don't you guys plug and promote your stuff? Where can people find you at?
Well, you can find me on ToonGrin.com. Like right now, we're just doing a sort of a reimagining of our videos and such, but we've just been doing like, you know, a lot sort of work for a different sort of YouTubers and all that, but we're still around creating all sorts of fun artwork, fun videos and everything. So just go to ToonGrin.com to see that.
Find me over at my YouTube channel called Fusionater. I'm sure there'll be a link somewhere. Yeah, I do reaction videos and stuff. Mostly that. Try and do other projects occasionally, and then school gets in the way. So that's me.
I'm kind of all over the internet, but most of the time I'm either on Twitter these days. With my Twitter handle is PaulThomas1992, mostly talking about Adventure Time. Technically, that's like my PhD account. Like, I'm a PhD student, so I'm like trying to connect with people, but it's turned into me just talking about Adventure Time. And then I'm also at my Tumblr, which is GunterFan1992, tumblr.com. That's where I do like a lot of my interviews and stuff. So either way, I'm more than happy to connect and chat and talk about why Marceline is the best character.
You know, that's actually funny. So Marceline is the best character for you, but yet your username on Tumblr is GunterFan1992.
People have always asked me that. Yeah, that, you got made fun of that. Well, made fun's a hard way, or a harsh way of putting it. But yeah, people always tease me about that. I don't remember why I picked GunterFan. I think when I first started, I was a little leery about you know, oh, my favorite character is a girl character.
Wow.
And now I'm just like, I don't really care, but I still have Gunter Fan as my name. And, but all the profile pictures I use are Marceline, which has ended up, I've been in some weird situations because of that, because people think I'm a lady, and I've had a few weird conversations online, but whatever.
It through the entire podcast without bringing up Gunter. So I'll say this. Cute penguins are life. There's that going for it.
I agree.
There you go. Especially if they're aliens.
Yes.
Yes.
That want to get into comets. Because reasons. Anyway, you can find me on youtube.com/oldschoollane, facebook.com/oldschoollane, oldschoollane.net. I'm on Twitter at patty_b_miranda. You can check out my podcasts on Anchor, Spotify, Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Radio Public, many places. New episodes of my podcast will go there first, and then they'll go up in a few days on YouTube. And I actually have an announcement. I actually have an upcoming interview this Friday that will be up on Anchor, and then it'll go up on YouTube on Sunday, that kind of relates to all of our talk on Adventure Time. Who's it going to be? Well, I'm not going to say it, but you'll have to tune in and find out. So thank you very much for listening, everyone. Let us know in the comments below about your thoughts on Adventure Time. What were your favorite characters? What were your favorite episodes, favorite moments, favorite songs, the legacy that they left behind? What are your thoughts on Distant Lands? You know, let us know about why Gunther's the best penguin ever. I don't know. So yeah, thank you so much, everybody. Hope to see you around soon, and take care.
Come along with me and the butterflies and bees. We can wander through the forest and do so as we please. Come along with me to a cliff under a tree, where we can gaze upon the water as an everlasting dream. All of my collections, I share them all with you. Maybe by next summer, we won't have changed our tune. We'll still want to be with the butterflies and bees, making up new numbers and living so merrily. All of my collections, I'll share them all with you. I'll be here for you always, and always be with you. Come along with me and the butterflies and bees. We can wander through the forest and do so as we please. living so merrily.